should be a right in this country. And a right is not $8.47 per hour. Now I want you to think of this. Before any store goes into a community, they do a demographic study. They look at the wage, they look at the education level, and they look at how informed people are, and they look at whether you are registered to vote, and in fact, if you do vote. Because if you don't vote, you have no voice. And they know that. One of the reasons we have the person in the White House we have today is not because he got so many, many votes, because people stayed home. They did not vote. So these are all of the kinds of things, these are the things that we look at in our community. These are the kinds of demographics that are looked at before they determine that they can place a Dollar General store in our community. Now, if we go all the way back in history and we consider the fact that during slavery, one of the things that they would not tolerate from slaves was to do what? Learn to read. Because if you learn to read, then you become informed. One of the reasons why these kinds of predatory businesses can come into our community is because our community is ill-informed. And so they put a store there, and people get happy, and they say, well, you know, it's close, and stuff is cheap, and I can afford it. But what they don't consider is this. The food that you buy there is full of sugars and salt. What do we find in our community? Diabetes, high blood pressure, cancer. If you have cancer, what's the first thing your doctor says to you? Don't eat certain kinds of food, correct? Well, that's what you find in the Dollar General store. And they know that we're not active. We don't come together. Poor folks, they don't have to worry about it. If it's a big issue, somebody gets shot, everybody can come together. But guess what? After that, where is everybody? There you go. So this is the reason why I'm passionate about this store. Yes, it's up. We couldn't prevent that. And why couldn't we prevent that? Because we did not have a say as to whether it came into our community or not. And why did we not have a say? Because our political representatives didn't let us know.
That's right.
Okay? So we have to begin to hold them accountable, but the only way we can do that is that we have to be educated, we have to be informed about the issues that confront our community every day. We have children in our schools who are not doing well. Did all of a sudden our children become so dumb? When I was in school, we weren't having the problems that we're having today. Granted, there are a lot of social issues, but why can they do what they do to us in our schools? Because we are uninformed and we don't participate. So I say to you today, that Dollar General store is up there. And it's going to be very difficult to get people to boycott, because people are going to say, I'm going to buy that because I can get it cheaper there. But you've got to inform your neighbor. Because all you've got to do is look at Governor Prince Boulevard and see what happened, okay? And that's the same thing that can happen to any community where people don't participate, where they're ill-informed, where they don't vote, okay? We've got to tell our young people, I know they say all the time, well, my vote doesn't matter. Your vote does matter, and I'll tell you why. When I worked with a politician on a campaign, and somebody called her up and said, I need you to help me with this problem. You know, first thing she did, she went to the voting rolls to see if that person was registered to vote and if they indeed did vote. And you know what she would say to them? You go register. Show me the registration, and then I help you. Because if you don't register to vote, if you don't vote, you can't help me, so I can't help you. So we are all in this together. And I say to all of you, we've got to care for each other. We've got to love each other. We've got to stop finding reasons to be upset with each other, and we've got to vote, become informed, and don't go to that Dollar General store. Thank you very much.
I woke up this morning with my man.
My name was.
This guy here is my personal hero. He had put countless hours and years in advocating, talking to politicians, engaging the community, kicking over tables to make this point expansion possible. Please, without further ado, let's give Mr. Kamoko Harris a round of applause.
Hello, everybody. Thank you for coming. I'm gonna give you a little update and a little background to the Port Expansion Project. And I think it's important so you can see how we got to this point because it's almost completed from the standpoint that the investor who is gonna take over and build the new facilities that are gonna create 5,000 plus jobs is just about close to being chosen and picked. And hopefully within the next few weeks, or at least within this month of December, that we'll know who the investor is. And when I say the investor or investors, I mean that group or that person or that company or that conglomerate of people that are going to put like close to $1.5 to $2 billion into development of these facilities. What does that mean? The current port is going to be expanded. Also, we're going to have a port built in Edgemoor, a brand new container port built in Edgemoor that's going to handle probably about 6 or 7 times more cargo than the current port. So when you translate that into jobs, you know what that means because you know how many jobs there are at the current port. You know, so when we're talking about 5,000 plus jobs, that's real. That's no exaggeration. 5,000 is probably just a low figure, but it's going to probably be closer to 8,000 to 10,000 overall. And it's going to be a container port. What does that mean? That most of the cargo that comes into the United States, or let me start this. Most of what you're wearing, what you listening to with your phone, when you go home, what you sit on, when you work on your car, what your tools are with, comes from some other place, from some other country, made not in the USA. And it gets into this country by ship. And what we're saying is that the container port we're gonna have built is gonna be bringing in containers full of clothes from Boscov's and Sears and JCPenney's. Tools for AutoZone and Advanced Auto, furniture from Levitt's and all these other kind of places. You know, dishes, all the stuff that you buy in the store, you see it's made in China or made somewhere else. So we're gonna start getting that kind of cargo in this new container port. Because right now, we're pretty much known for fruit. Everybody knows about Dole and Chiquita, basically fruit, we're a fruit port. That's the major, we're number one in the country, the nation, you know, in terms of fruit. Small as Wilmington is, we are the number one fruit dock in the whole country. So the jobs that are going to be created are real. What other kind of jobs are there? Construction, because it has to be built. So there's going to be hundreds of construction jobs. And Jimmy Martelli is here, thanks to Jimmy, you know, that those jobs, those construction jobs, have to be union. They have to be union, so a lot of our construction brothers and sisters who have been out of work because the promise of the infrastructure money and all that stuff that idiot in the White House promised, we're gonna do this, it ain't happening. So a lot of our brothers and sisters who are in construction are out of work. So this port is gonna create hundreds of construction jobs. Also, truck driving jobs. Guys to drive trucks, because the new ships that we're going to be getting at the new facility are going to be five and six times bigger than the biggest ships we get at the port now. So we may have a ship that has 6,000-7,000 boxes on it, containers on it. Right now, the largest ship we get has 1,000. So each one of those boxes is going to have to be driven from the port somewhere. So there may be 1,000 truck moves a day. That's 1,000 truck drivers a day. You know, and I'm telling you all this because we want, that's why we have to, because we want y'all to be ready to get these jobs. You know, because all our kids not going to college, most of our kids, if you look at the statistics, less than 50% of them graduated from high school. A lot of our kids have felonies, and they can't work no place else but the port and construction. That's where we, you know, you got a felony, so what? Are you ready to go to work? You know, that's the question. And that's what we're dealing with. You know, and this is important. So the first thing you need to do, the question is, what do I need to do? Number one, you need to apply for your TWIC card. Apply for your TWIC card. 618. 618 Lampson Lane. That's the office. Lampson Lane. L-O-M-B-S-O-N. Lampson Lane is right, you know, right down from Simon's Gardens. As soon as you turn up Newcastle Avenue to Lampson Lane, you come straight on down. It's on the left-hand side. So that's what the first thing you have to do is get your TWIC card. Because you cannot work at a port or any port without a TWIC card. The TWIC card costs, I think it's $128, $125. All right? Okay. But your TWIC card. Your TWIC is your Transportation Worker Identification Credential. That's what the TWIC stands for.
And how long does that process take to get that card?
And let me
ask
a question.
Yeah. Well, you know, that's the first thing you need to do. If you have a felony, or not even a felony, if you have a misdemeanor, you may get denied at first. But there's a process that we fought for here when they first started the trip. And I led the organization and the struggle to change it. And we have an appeal process and a waiver process. So if you do have what is considered a disqualifying offense, you can have it appealed or waived. And in most cases, they are appealed and waived. Short of you've been convicted of running into, down Dover, running into the city county building with a bomb and trying to blow it up, you can get waived. You can get waived.
How long does that process take to get that TWIC card?
30 days.
It varies because you have to show, get fingerprinted, they give you a background check and all that kind of stuff.
Okay, come on,
you know, so not to change my finger though, because I'm saying, and this process here is good because I'm saying we have the construction trades, the building trades, and we have the ILA, which are the only two industries that basically, that if you've made a mistake somewhere in your life and history, it's not held against you. It's not held against you. And that's important. You know, and like I say, get your TWIC card. That's the first thing you need to do, get that TWIC card. And basically, to bring it to where it is now, when they started out the process of calling out for applicants, people to send in applications or send in proposals to do the port, it started out at 60. It was 60 people that responded from around the world. You know, banks, trust funds, you know, around the world. Then it was narrowed down to 10. Then the 10 went to 3. And it's at 3 now. And like I said, hopefully soon that it's going to be down to one, and we're going to know who that one is, and then we're going to begin the process, or at least they'll begin the process of planning what's going to happen at the port, when they're going to start building, and all that kind of stuff. Also, once that proposal is done, it's going to have to go to Dover and be voted on by the legislatures in Dover. And if necessary, we want to take, or if somebody's down there acting stupid, meaning some of them legislators act like they want to fight against us, then we'll take 15 or 20 busloads of people from here, and we'll go down the road and make sure that they vote like they're supposed to vote. You know, so I want you to be on the ready, if necessary. Hopefully it's not necessary, because the state is in bad shape. Like people said, we lost GM, we lost Chrysler, we lost DuPont, we lost thousands of good paying blue collar jobs, you know, and the state is in bad shape, and the port, expansion of the port is really the only avenue right now that is guaranteed to create thousands and thousands of blue collar jobs. And like I said, through the port work, through working on the docks, through the construction and making building on the port, trucking, I'm saying, so we're the only thing left. You know, so if we got to fight for it, then that's what we need to do. So that, like, stay on alert. If we didn't put the call out and say, look, we need to be down Dover on such and such a date, and we're going to have busloads of people meeting us here outside this hall, the shooting aisle of the Union Hall, we need your support and we need you to be ready. Thank you. I'm done.
Before we introduce our next panelist, anybody have any questions for Ms. Smithers or Kamoko before we move on? Any questions?
Where can I apply for a foot card?
Wait, just raise your hand, I'll come to you.
What does, how is the expiration date of once you get a foot card? How long does it last? Is there a time frame for
5 years.
18
5 years. 5 years. Every 5 years you must reapply.
Where can I apply for this foot card at?
618 Lamps.
618 Lamson Lane, Newcastle.
As far as the TWIC card goes, you can also apply online at tsa.gov. That's Thomas Sally Alice.gov. It makes it a lot more easier. They're going to actually show you the address, directions how to get over to the TWIC office on Lamson Lane, and they'll give you all the information that you need, questions to answer, tsa.gov.
Also, you need to know that the TSA offices and where you get that TWIC card are different places. When it comes up on the computer, if you're not in this area, let's say you live down Middletown, down Dover, you can get your TWIC card down there. If you live in New Jersey, there's a place for you to get it in New Jersey to get your TWIC card. Okay, just to get it, but we're promoting local hire here.
Yeah, that's
okay. Anything else? Any more questions?
Hey, yes, good morning. I'm a CEO holder. I like to know when you go for the 5 years truck job. That's what I do.
So the brother, he has a CDL license, and he's interested to find out how do you hook up to these truck driving jobs.
Well, I don't know the particular answer to that. Does anybody know the answer to that? Is Jimmy, you got any ideas? Any teams is here?
I also want to say, we got a very important segment that's called a program that we're going to bring here. We got our colleagues here, my mentor here from New York, and that program is going to be set up to help us develop the pipeline to these different trades. So even though the Teamsters aren't here, we will have that discussion and develop that pipeline for those individuals that's interested into those tracks. So that's why listening to the program with P2A is going to be very important to know the functions. Okay, without further ado, it's time for me to turn the mic over to the watchman. This guy, this man, this hero has been the state head of the NAACP, the regional head, and he's now a city councilman at large two times. Sam Guy is the one who say things when nobody else would say it. He kicks the table, and he's our hero, and he's our voice. So please, let's give the watchman a round of applause and welcome.
Thank you, John, appreciate that. First of all, what I want to say to all of you is that organizing is important. Okay, that's the framework of my remarks. So in this room, we have workers who, some are part of labor, and some are on their own, which means they're not organized with anybody, which means they're subject to the whim of anybody. Okay? The contractors organize. They meet. They get together, and they reach agreements on what they're going to spend their money on, what elected officials they're going to support, so that they can change the policies so that they win the game of reaching into your pocket and taking part of your paycheck to go into their pocket. That's what Trump's doing with the tax policy, right? He wants to take the money from the regular people and put it in the pocket of the rich people because his team won. So a lot of us, we cried. But we had 8 people in Wilmington and 9 people running for mayor, so the people who want to reach in your pocket, Pazicki and his developer friend, they won. So guess what they're going to try to do? Reach in your pocket as long as they're there. The winners get to drive the ship. Okay, you got to face that. So now the question is, the elected official or any elected official can't control the game, because it's too many people. For every elected official, there's 1 million people. So they can't win as long as the people organize. So what I want to do, first of all, is, where's John Block? Because I don't see him, but I want to thank him for his visionary leadership and all of the people who are part of the LEAP leadership, because like I need everybody to look around the room for a quick second. Spin your heads around and look around the whole room. And what I want you to notice in this room is that I've been in the game a long time. And very seldom do you walk in a room where the people are in the room and the labor people are in the room, all together trying to work together for the people to win. This is like a whole new thing going on here. Because you got to ask yourself, all y'all ain't out here for nothing. There's something that you feel that's important that's being attempted here.
That's right.
So you got to stay strong, you got to stay vigilant, because we didn't get in this mess in 2 weeks. So don't go trying to, you know, tell folks you didn't do anything today. No, it's a long fight. You got to be in it for the long haul. So I have a broad topic dealing with justice. So that allows me to move around to a couple of different things. So one of the first things I want to start off with is, back in the day, who's old enough to remember 2 movements, 1 goal?
Oh yeah.
Okay, you got it. So I left part of it off. It was organized labor in the NAACP. 2 movements, 1 goal. See, back in the day, the civil rights community and organized labor worked together very closely. And then there were some people who tried to drive a wedge. But now those folks who are trying to drive a wedge, they're being exposed, and you see the people and organized labor getting back together. That's important to notice as a movement. There's a couple of programs that I want to just bring to your attention. So I want you to Google some things. I can't cover all of these, but I want you to Google these when you get home. There's something called a prevailing wage. I want you to Google that term when you get home. Prevailing wage, Delaware.
Me and all my friends, we're all misunderstood. They say we stand for nothing and there's no way we ever could. Now I see everything that's going wrong with the world and the...
So that you have a sense of the framework for how wages are set with respect to governmental projects that meet certain criteria. So when you look at that, right, there's something I want you to notice, because the real question is, what is the prevailing wage? In other words, the prevailing wage means, what's the wage that's paid for that job in this particular county? Because they set a rate for different counties. And so as a worker, you want that number to be high, right? But the people paying want that number to be low. So the way the government has this structured is they do a survey of the people who pay workers. Well, they have an incentive to either not fill out the form or do something that will result in wages being low. That's just a automatic thing that they would want. So when you read about that, particularly pay attention to how wages are set for employment on government projects. That's important. There's another concept I want you to Google. It's called a local hire policy.
Me and all my friends, we're all misunderstood. They say we stand for nothing and there's no way. Now we see everything that's going wrong with the world and the...
We need local hire policies. We need the law to be on your side so that the government and folks who do work for the government have to hire people locally, have to use contractors that hire local workers. Because if you notice, because I pay attention, like, I go by a job site, and most of the license plates are out of state. And a whole lot of the people working there, I don't see no whole lot of people in this room at the job site. In fact, that's what we need. One of y'all young people, come up with some kind of hashtag about no workers on a site. Come up with something so that everybody can take pictures, and anytime they see a site where nobody's working, they hashtag it and send it there. Then we can start like building a digital record of the importance of local hire. Then there's something called Section 3. That's a federal program. Like the other day, like a lot of times I'll hear something and it'll trigger certain thoughts in my mind. So I'm gonna give you this one. The other day I read they wanna build this new basketball facility behind South Bridge.
Ambitious project that we think reflects the yes we can attitude of our city and our state governor. I think it reflects our aspirations for our city and this part of town.
Kids in our neighborhood, the children growing up in Southbridge and on the east side, West Center City on the west side. As Mike said, I've been out knocking on doors, talking to parents and grandparents about what their expectations are for us in providing educational opportunities for their children. But frankly, we're not doing a very good job right now. One of the ways that we can show a signal to our children that we care about them and their education is to make this kind of investment, to bring this kind of an institution that they love to our city.
Well, my thought immediately was, okay, they're using federal money, state money, what kind of money are they using? Because that can impact, you know, the impact can be which required program applies to that project, which was the same thought when they said they were going to build a bridge that basically comes to South Bridge and in the waterfront. And I'm saying, okay, so are they going to comply with Section 3? Are people in the community going to have any role in any of those jobs? Does that law apply? So we have to really pay attention to every time you hear a project announced, you need to pay attention and try to understand what special programs exist. Because these programs exist to counterbalance the effort to exploit workers. I mean, let's just be plain about it. It's just basically people want to exploit the workers. If you don't understand that, you got to get there first. I know everybody wants to feel like people don't want to do those kind of things. People don't want to take advantage of people. In the name of money, people will pay you $2 an hour to work if they can get away with it. The last speaker spoke about that. Okay? So, people in this room are basically trying to inform you so that you can protect yourself and so that we can work together to make sure that you're protected. That's what this room represents and LEAP and what's going on here. Because, like I said earlier, the exploiters are meeting. Did you all read that in Sussex County they tried to pass a right to work law? Yes. Are y'all aware of that?
Yes.
That is an anti-organizing law. Let's be blunt. If the object of unions is to organize the workers so that you're treated fair, the object of right to work is to try to interfere with folks being organized to protect you.
Me and all my friends, we're all misunderstood. They say we stand for nothing and there's no way we ever could. Now we see everything that's going wrong with the world. And
that's what that's all about. But doesn't it sound so nice, right to work? If you didn't know what right to work was and they interviewed you on CNN and asked you, are you for right to work? We'd all put our hands up, wouldn't we? And then we'd just be suckers when our friends see us on TV saying we're for right to work. That's why you gotta read. Somebody said earlier about the importance of reading, learning to read, paying attention. If you're not able to read, that's okay. Then listen to what's being said, right? Because everything's on video and audio nowadays. So you can still participate no matter what your knowledge level is for these fancy words. And folks will interpret them for you. What's really important is to show up. Now, 100 times 100 is what? Anybody got that? 100 times 100. So that's four zeros with a one in front of it. That's $10,000. During the last budget, I said to the city government people during the budget process, you know, we should put $10,000 in the budget to buy Twit cards for city residents. We use money on all other types of stuff. So what the problem is even our local governments, like you all have to make your local government organize for working people.
That's right.
If you go to city council and you look at the committees, you won't find any committee that's designed to address the issues that's on this agenda. So that means that's a government with 9 black people out of 13 that have not organized to be concerned about you working, but every living soul ran on jobs. Now how can you not talk about this stuff and claim you're for jobs? Now I said there's non-black people because that means that includes me, right? But I can show you what I've tried to do to deal with stuff. Because I tried to create a judiciary committee so that we could take these same issues and bring them to live council meetings and address them and make the government officials at the state and county and federal level come and be accountable. But our folks didn't want to organize for success. I just got finished being quoted in the paper. Where's the Wilmington Civil Rights Commission? It don't exist. Why? Because folks don't want to organize for our success. The people. Folks ain't organized for the people. Go look at the city council committees and you'll see it's organized for the folks that already have to have a place to come address what they want to address. Not a place where the people can come get addressed what the people need addressed. So, in conclusion, this is what I'm gonna say. Any of y'all ever heard of Pity Pat?
Yeah.
And right, the house, right, they want some money off the top, don't they?
Yeah.
Basically, we're here meeting about the efforts to keep people from taking from you off the top. Right? That's what we're trying to prevent, so that when you get your paycheck, your money's there. And there's nothing wrong with there being part of union wages being in place to help the organization to continue to be able to meet your needs. But there's people who are trying to get you to believe that you'd be better off with some kind of right to work, so that, in a sense, you're alone. They can pick you off one at a time. You ain't got a shot alone. You ain't got no shot whatsoever. And I'm a lawyer telling you that. Because I know I don't have a shot alone. I just don't let everybody see who all the people are that's with. Because I don't want them to get shot. So with that, I'm going to wrap it up. And because I go on and on and on, and that ain't the purpose of today. So thank you all for listening and hearing me, and thanks, Leek, for inviting me.
We would like to know at this time if you have any questions for Brother Sam Guy. He's doing a phenomenal job with us. He's a legacy person here in the state of Delaware, and he fights for us. Any questions? Yes, ma'am.
I just want to commend Mr. Guy on his position, and we need to get more people like him to help support him. So this is what we're talking about. When we say you got to get out and vote, because your vote counts and your vote does matter, especially with local government. If we're going to support people that look like us, then they need to be helping us. And he needs help.
Sam Guy down there in Dover.
Yeah.
We need Sam Guy in Dover.
I'm looking at all of the displays, and I've been around to the tables, and I've spoken to them, and so far I've getting the same answer of what they have to be qualified for to get into the apprenticeship programs. And the main thing is everybody's telling me, okay, they have to have a high school diploma. A lot of our young people, for some reason, either dropped out of school, didn't have the opportunity, had to stay home and work for that family and take care of that family. So they're not going to be able to get that shot because they're being held up for that reason. And I was told a couple of times, this gentleman here told me that they had a good job for. Well, if you look around and you see most of these young people, they're over the requirement of age to be able to get into a program like that. So could you explain that to me?
Yeah, you are kind of jumping, but good question. That's the reason why we're working with our folks here at the table, Pathways to Apprenticeship. there's going to be about 13 to 15 different programs, union programs that we're going to try to, that we're going to give people access to. Each program has a different criteria, right? Like we have Local 55. Local 55's requirement is 18 years and older, physically able to do the work, and drug clean. But that doesn't mean for an electrician union, which is a totally different trade, you're going to need a certain competency level, you're going to have to pass their test. So what P2A is going to do, and they'll talk about the program of how we get people on their correct paths. So that's what we're here for today. There's going to be some problems that we got to work through together. But today we're going to talk about some of the best practices and some solutions that we found, and we're going to implement them. So, sure.
You asked me that question, because a lot of times people ask me questions because you're willing to accept my answer.
Amen.
And this is what I'm going to tell you. First thing is, we all in here together.
Yes.
That's a new thing.
Yes.
The fact that you actually are talking to people at the table that are representatives from the union, that's a whole new thing. What we still really have going to have to work on is how to navigate from A to Z.
Yes.
And we're here together to try to do that, and we don't have it perfected yet, so that you know. But we are working on it, and this has never, any of y'all that are elders, have you ever been in the room with the actual representatives of the folks to be even available to ask them where the office is?
Never.
So we're not where you want us to be yet, but we got a real good start going on.
I just want to say that he's talking about organizing. It is so, so important, and being there, showing up. I just want to say to everyone, not even, but especially to some young people. I was at a city council meeting a few months or so ago, and there were some young boys there. They had got together, and they came to that city council meeting because Mr. Guy was about to pass legislation that now you can be 25 years old and become mayor. And when these young boys got up to speak before the legislation was passed, and after it was passed, these young boys just about cried because of the legislation that was passed they were trying years ago to get it passed to lower the age of a person becoming mayor. So now, young men, at the age of 25, you can become the mayor of the city of Wilmington, thanks to Honorable Sam Guy. So it's important that you go show up and be at the city council meetings, because a lot of times, when he tries to get legislation through, they knock him down, do all kinds of stuff to him up there, and he's fighting for us. I mean, he fights for us. So begin to go to those meetings. Show up like you showed up today. And I'm just going to say thank you. Thank you.
Thank you guys for coming. Real quick, if anybody that's an elected official, can you just raise your hand so people will know who you are, because there's a lot of things that's going on today. It's a busy Saturday, but they came here to support this. I wouldn't be nowhere else but here, because this is who I came and ran for. You know what I mean? The local 199 saved my life. You know, I was on hard times about 15 years ago, and the local 199, I wouldn't pay my last $500. It was $499 or $450. To get a car. You know, went down refining, was working down there for 4 months. Got me back. Some of y'all that had jobs at 199, you see those checks, it gets you back. You know what I mean? So right now we have an opportunity to save our community. This right here is an opportunity for us to save our community. What's been hurting our community is people making side deals.
That's right.
Let's keep it real. We gotta eliminate the side deals. Everybody want to make a side deal. Right now, when I looked at that newspaper and seen $26 million in the new arena, the first thing I said was, ain't no side deal on that. Because we need laborers. We need union workers at that job site.
That's right.
We need you guys at that job site. So just like you showed up today, When we call for y'all to go stand with us, we need you to show up that day. Understand? Like Sam said, it ain't no two-week process. It ain't no two-week process. We need everybody in this room to bring five other people when we call you to go stand so we can get y'all a job. Understand, I didn't run for office for the money. I got offered a job in Charlotte 3 times the amount I made in city council. I stayed there for you guys. Amen. So you guys got to stand with us. I say it every time, hold us accountable. If I ain't doing the job, vote me out of there. Vote me out of there. Vote everybody else out of there. You feel what I'm saying? Just like Ms. Smith said, the lady looked at the voting list. That's how they do it. When you protest, what they do, they take the facial image and check and see if you a registered voter. You got 200 people there and 20 people registered voters. You ain't did nothing. You ain't did nothing. So like everybody in this room, all y'all might say y'all registered to vote. Nah, pull your phone out and register to vote today. Because you ain't hurting nothing if you vote, you register to vote twice. Let them figure it out. They can pay you for it. But y'all make sure y'all register to vote. Straight up. And go and listen. We rallied when we had beef in the hood in our community. We go get everybody in the community and go, let's go fight. Well, let's go fight. We in a battle. We need y'all.
Oh, man, that's really good. And actually, those that want to register to vote, during lunch, we have the booth out there, and you can actually start the process today.